DIY.
Hello YouTube and welcome to Heathen Hacks. Today we're going to make a very simple nightlight using a few basic components and a super easy to understand circuit. For context, a few days ago, out of curiosity, I have decided to see how long can a CR2032 button cell battery last if I attach two pieces of 3mm white LEDs to it. I used electrical tape to quote-unquote fuse them together and a piece of double-sided tape to stick it onto the wall. I was quite surprised because 5 days later, it's still giving power to the LEDs.
A bit of an update, it's been 12 days now and it's still lit up. I repeat, it's been 12 days now and it's still lit up, just with lower brightness.
That made me wonder if I can use the same battery to power my DIY nightlight. Spoiler alert, it did not work as I have expected. I ended up changing stuff twice, so now I have 3 versions of it, and since the video would be too long if I include the first version, I've decided not to. Also, all the necessary links would be provided on the description down below. Let's go! Here are the things that we need. First up is a prototype PCB where we will be soldering everything, a breadboard for testing the circuit, 8 pieces of 5mm white LEDs. You can use whatever color you prefer and however many you want as long as your power supply can handle it, 2 pieces of 100 ohm resistors which I have changed to lower valued ones later on, a slide switch to turn the lights on or off, a few solid core and stranded hookup wires, 2 pieces of 18650 lithium-ion batteries which was the leftover from my DIY power bank. Click right here to check it out if you want. A vice grip or a pair of needle nose pliers would be handy as well. Wire strippers, flushed wire cutters, soldering iron and soldering lead, and last but not the least, a transparent enclosure. This is from my old RTA, by the way. It's made of acrylic. Okay, by this point I have already tested the circuit using the breadboard and everything is working just fine. So let's proceed with the soldering. First up, let's work on the LEDs. Bend the legs like this in order to separate the anodes from the cathodes. The anodes are the ones on the inside part. Now let's add a bare solid core hookup wire to connect all of the anodes together. Just like this. To make sure that all of the anodes are properly connected, let's do a continuity test using the multimeter. Then, let's connect the first 4 cathodes to a 100 ohm resistor and then connect the other side to another 100 ohm resistor as well. Alright, let's start! Well, it does look a bit ugly though. I think I'll just redo it off cam, then I'll be back later, okay? So I just finished resoldering the connections under the prototype PCB. As you can see here, it looks cleaner now.
Well, relatively speaking.
After that, of course, we need to perform another test. This time to make sure that all the LEDs are lighting up when hooked up to the battery. Let's test the top part first and then the bottom one next. After that, let's check if the PCB would fit inside the enclosure. The PCB fits just right, but the lid would not close because of the LEDs, so we need to do some adjustments. Then solder the batteries and add the slide switch as well. I think I'll just do those off cam again. Just for transparency, this is the start of version 2. This time we're going to change the 100 ohm resistors to 47 ohms. This is the schematic diagram. Since we're going to be using 2 pieces of 18650 batteries that are connected in parallel and with lower voltage but higher capacity, I think it would be just fine. So I have already soldered the hookup wires to the battery holder's negative and positive terminals off cam. Red is obviously the positive and white is the negative. Let's check the voltages of the batteries to make sure that they both have the same charge left. Battery 1 is 4.17 volts or let's just say 4.2 volts. Battery 2 is just about the same as well, so we don't need to charge anything just yet. Now let's insert the batteries to the battery holder while making sure that they are both on the correct polarity. Okay, let's check the voltages again. Still about 4.2 volts, which is perfect. What we're going to do next is to replace the 100 ohm resistors with the 47 ohm ones. After replacing the resistors, we need to drill some holes right here and right here so that the wires from the battery holder can go inside the case. And of course, I'm going to use my Makita drill with a 2mm drill bit. After drilling some holes and inserting the positive and negative wires through it, I have also used super glue to secure the battery holder to the bottom back part of the case. Next thing to do is to solder the battery's terminal wires to the switch. After soldering the battery's terminals to the switch, I have also added some heat shrink sleeves so that they would be isolated from each other. Next up is adding some hot glue onto the wires that are connected to the switch, to both isolate them from each other and sort of secure them inside the acrylic case. I would also add some hot glue onto the feet of the standoff so that the PCB won't move around inside. So here's what the version 2 of this project looks like. As we take a closer inspection, just like on my PC, the back of it is chaos, but the front of it is quite presentable. Alright, let's insert the batteries again. Let's turn it on to see if it works. Let's do another test. It's getting 2.8 volts for the voltage and 20 milliamps for the current. I guess we just need to do a real-world test to see how long it would last, eh? The reason why I chose to secure the batteries at the bottom back part of the case was to keep the center of gravity low to keep it from falling over. Also for the ease of taking out the battery and charging it using my vape battery charger. Now, before we move on to the third iteration, as we have done with the earlier versions, let's do some tests yet again. Let's insert the batteries, get our multimeter, plug in the test probes, set it to voltage, turn the nightlight on, and just as expected, the LEDs are receiving 2.8 volts and 19 milliamps just like before. Meanwhile, the power supply or batteries are now outputting 3.9 volts instead of 4.2 volts like on the test earlier. The reason for that was because this has been used thrice already and at about 6 to 8 hours each night, so naturally, the capacity or charge went down by a little. Alright, since this is going to be the final version, or let's just say the version before the final one, we'd want our LEDs to last long, and upon learning some new and additional information, I have decided to connect a 47 ohm resistor in series with all the LEDs instead of just using two and then connect them all in parallel. That way, all the LEDs would receive the same amount of current. Not only that, the underside of the PCB would also have a cleaner look. Here's the schematic diagram for it. So I'd be removing this solid core hookup wire right here, and then solder the resistors right here. Now that it's done, here's what it looks like. This is the front, and this is the back side or what's under the PCB. See? It's relatively more presentable now. As usual, after every revision, we need to perform some tests. It looks like instead of getting 2.8 volts, the LEDs are now getting 3 volts. Now let's check its current draw. The current draw varies from 24 milliamps to 26 milliamps. And instead of having a uniform current draw, some of them are different now. Interesting. Let's check the voltage output of the power supply. The power supply is outputting 3.9 volts just like before. Now, just to confirm if we have picked the correct resistor, let's use DigiKey's LED series resistor calculator. At 3.9 volts of supply voltage, 3 volts of forward voltage or voltage drop, and 26 milliamps of forward current, the resistor that we should use is 34.615 or 35 ohms. And since we're using 47 ohm resistors, we're safe, I think. After checking the output voltage of the power supply, let's check the total current draw. And to properly measure the current draw of all the LEDs connected, I'm going to snip this wire that's carrying the positive voltage from the power supply. Just to be safe, I have also removed the batteries. Now let's hook up the two ends of the wire to my multimeter's test probes. Insert the batteries again. Turn on the multimeter and set it to milliamps. My guess is it would show 208 milliamps of current draw because each LED is using 26 milliamps of current and there are 8 of them. Or I don't know, I could be totally wrong as well. It does not seem to display the correct values. Oh, right! Don't forget to insert the other probe to the ammeter terminal. As you can see, as soon as I have plugged in the other probe to the ammeter terminal, the LEDs lit up right away because the switch is on apparently. Let me just switch the places of these probes for a moment. So it's currently drawing 103 milliamps. Now, to be able to make sense of things, let's try and use Ohm's law to find the total current draw. And since we already have it, let's find the resistance instead by using an Ohm's law calculator. So that would be 3.6 on the voltage, 103 milliamps on the current, and then click on calculate. According to the calculator, the resistance is about 35 ohms if we round it off. After that, let's clear everything and input the voltage and resistance, then click on calculate. See that? Current is showing 102.859 or 103 milliamps. But if we take the total current draw, which is 103 milliamps, and divide it to the total number of connected LEDs, we would get about 13 milliamps. Confusing, isn't it? It could be because of a lot of different factors, such as the resistor's reliability, temperature, soldering, and a lot more. By the way, if you have any idea why, please do let me know. Thanks. Well, I think since this is just for a simple nightlight and not for a mission-critical project, we can move on for now. Right? I mean, the parts are really easy to replace anyway, so yeah. After resoldering the wire that we have snipped earlier, let's do another test. This test was performed after the device was used for the fourth time, by the way. So, output voltage of the power supply is now down to 3.6 volts. Weirdly enough, unlike from the earlier test, the LEDs are getting 2.9 volts now instead of 3 volts. Current draw is now down to 24 milliamps compared to the earlier test, which was 26. And the 3.6 volt supply voltage, 2.9 volts forward voltage, and 24 milliamps forward current, the resistor value should be 29.167 or 30 ohms. And since we're using 47 ohms, we're still safe, I think. Not sure if the changes were because of the soldering or if the LEDs or resistors somehow got damaged or degraded, but they're all working as of now, so all is good.
This is fine.
I guess we'd find out after a few more nights of usage, huh? Thanks for watching and see you again next week. Maybe.